I went to the OTU on mosquitoes.
Okay.
And I finished OTU the very end of November 1943, when they asked for volunteers to go to the Middle East.
Okay.
So that's when, well, I asked my navigator, who first started flying together. He came down to the flight line for a ride in there. He was left over from a previous course. I said, okay, Paul, we'll go fly together. But I want to ask you one thing. How would you like to win the Victoria Cross? He said, don't be bloody stupid. I said, okay, I agree with you. We'll make one attack on a train or an airplane. We won't go back for another bite. And that's what we'll do. So I'm going to make a good attack, airplane or train, but not going back for another bite. And another thing that a good tip I got, if you start jinking around like this, doing turns as they come up with a searchlight in any aircraft fire, they're going from the following line of laying off deflection according to the longitudinal axis of the airplane. Sticky Murphy, who was lost, said, George, I'm going to tell you something that may really help you someday. When you're going in to bomb the aerodrome after having patrolled it for an hour and they know you're there, instead of jerking around and getting pushed around by searchlights and flak, just do a nice, gentle, slipping turn.
And throw them off.
And
yeah, because they'll think you're going this way, but you really...
Steve, in the last 15 trips, we were not coned once.
Wow.
And we're right overhead.
Wow.
So that was just totally awesome.
Yeah, well, that's yeah. Great. That's great advice.
But it was a great... I loved the Canadian Air Force and everything, but I wanted to get on an RAF squadron because I felt that they're the guys who were there first and they got a lot of experience and goodness knows where they would be. And they might take pity on somebody like me, a fledgling. But they would be the people who I felt would have a lot of help for somebody like myself to be... a good operational pilot. And did I ever get, that was so full. My CO, Sticky Murphy, DSO and bar, DFC and bar, Krautegger and Palma, check metal.
Wow.
Dropping and picking up spies in occupied Europe at night with three flashlights, here, here, and here, in a Lysander's. And the commanding officer of the station was... Sammy Hoare, group captain, who had a mustache with a 12-inch wingspan. They always talked about that. And Sammy Hoare, these were the sort of elite people who were at Cambridge and Eton. These were the upper crust, but they were bloody brave. Sammy Hoare was the one who had one eye through his mosquito at night. He was a bit like one of those people, you know. Like peerage. His uncle was Sir Samuel Hoare of the Home Office. Sammy Hoare was over Eastern Germany and got hit in an oil line. And he had to alternate engines in the Mosquito to get home.
Wow.
And he's written up in the Rolls Royce Annals. He was an absolute brilliant airman. But, you know, he DSO and bar, DFC and bar, all of those things. And after the war, he went to, he was taking a mosquito to New Zealand. And he was in Singapore. And Marion and I, recently, the last year or so, were up at St. Jacob's to have a nice lunch up there. And I saw that this English guy was ahead, and I had an 1861 English penny, and I said to him, I said, do you think they might have changed for this? He said, my word, an English penny. He said, did you get that in England? I said, yes, I did. Were you in the Air Force? Yes. He said, did you fly? I said, yeah. Were you a pilot? Yes. What did you fly? I said, mosquitoes. So did I. Post-war. He was posted to Singapore. He says, one day, did you know Sammy Hoare? I said, yes, he was our station commander. He said, well, I was in Singapore one day, my commanding officer called me in and said, I'd like you to meet Group Captain Hall. He's taking this Mosquito to New Zealand, and would you mind getting us a cup of tea? He said, I'd be happy to. So we gathered him a cup of tea, and he left the room. That was the last they ever saw of Sammy Hoare. Sammy Hoare got to the Gulf of Carpentaria and got in a typhoon or something, and he landed, the wreckage was found on some bit of an island or something. And they say he was eaten alive by land crabs and kept a diary. I don't exactly believe that. But that's what happened. He never made it. After all that DSO-NBAR, DFC-NBAR, flying with one eye, and all those, that experience. And so it was so tragic, but so poignant that... I would get to know those guys. Then the other thing I have to tell you about is they have the squadron ditty.
Okay.
The squadron ditty is this. The squadron motto was press on regardless.
Okay.
And the ditty that it came from is this. Press on regardless. Never mind the weather. Press on regardless. We'll all go in together. Press on regardless. It's just a piece of cake, because you'll never see the Dummer or the Steinhuder Lake. Going through Mepelenswolde in Holland, we go to the Dummer Lake and then the Steinhuder Lake. So that was our entry through between Mepelenswolde.
Oh, okay. So that was like how you got
Sticky into... Murphy, we thought, was lost at Gutterslow, and I was sent there on my 48th trip to see if I could make head or tail. He was actually shot down at Zwolle. So he was on his way in. So you don't know it all, you know, sometimes years later.
Yeah.
So that's what we found out. So I learned so much. And Jackie Curd telling me, George, I'm going to tell you something that will save your life someday. He was the CO of Navigator when he flew with the CO. But he wasn't with the CO when he was lost. When you're flying this airplane, get your speed up as fast as you can. I said, oh, why? Well, it happens that the single engine safety speed with the gear up and ready to go is about 170 miles an hour at least. So you try to get 180 miles an hour before you climb out. The tail comes up at 70 miles an hour. So if you lose an engine there, you can only close both throttles and hope you stop before the end of the runway. And so what I developed a system later on about the Chinese deal. So instead of starting off with everything idle, you line up to take off and you hold the brakes on, a hand grip like the old streetcars used to have, and pull the stick back in your chest, you know, and then you, instead of starting off at zero, because both 12-foot props swing the same direction, the torque pulls you off to the left. So I developed a system when I was instructing on them. You pull back on the stick and you push the power up to 2,000 RPMs, which is zero boost manifold pressure. And at the same time, as you would push the stick full forward and the power to the gate, you'd go full right rudder to stop the left turn. And it was that simple.
And you had the tail up pretty much right away.
The tail came up, no, but the tail came up, I had takeoff power by the time I had run the length of the air,
length of the airplane.
The airplane. But it would come up at about 70 miles an hour.
Okay,
so I'd have that pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm.
If we wanted to get up sooner, then we could put down a bit of flap. But we didn't like to do that because that would compromise your overshoot and losing an engine.
Yeah, your single engine capability.
The one time that I did line up, I was in China. This is sort of relates to takeoff. It looked like a Chinese guy down there on the runway. And I thought, oh my goodness. Well, we'll just take off and come close to him. It was a horse. He just walked away.
Just walked away. Didn't, yeah.
So I was very careful about getting the airspeed up. So what I did, as fast as I could do it, I got off the air, off the ground, stopped the wheels, changed hands, and lifted the gear, changed hands, and held it down until I got 180 miles an hour, which would give me good control if I lost one engine. So you can't climb out unless you have got speed, something like that. So that's what I did, and I'm sure that helped me with my safety in flying the airplane.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
It didn't turn out to just be a smart thing to do. It was good advice, which I passed on to dozens of people.
Oh, I bet.
And after the war, when they were sold to China, I would, you know, show them that. But it was a marvelous airplane. People like Jeffrey de Havilland were... they weren't good pilots. They were miraculous pilots. And when he first flew that airplane, you know, nobody had flown a Mosquito, but he had done like vertical rolls and that sort of stuff, something we would never think to do, but a marvelous thing. But then he was doing a pass one time and the tail came apart and he was killed.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So, but the ferry pilots used to lose a few and never hear from them. And that's when they discovered this little thing about
the spar.
Stiffener across
yeah.
They found one where it had broken in half. There's a friend, an intruder. So anyway, I picked up a lot of little things like that because, you know, I had no background, and I was confident but cautious, but I wanted to learn as much as I could from anybody who would tell me.
Mm-hmm.
And so the other thing is this business of radio chatter. We're at the gunnery course in Chedworth, and they had ladies in the tower, said, please watch your language. If you said something nasty or naughty,
mm-hmm.
you had to go up to the tower and they would read it to you.
Okay.
My friend Ken Eastwood, oh, I had an accident in a Mosquito and it came apart and all.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Is this during training?
When I was on the squadron.
Okay.
What happened was some guy had turned on one wheel and wrecked the tire. So when I came into land and touched down, the tire blew, and I got it off again and flew past the tower, and the CO said, well, your starboard tire is blown. He said, George, if you can bring it in with the gear down, we won't have to change the propeller. I'll try it, sir. I had an air cadet up for a ride. So I went off and flew around a little bit, and I did my downwind check, got the tail, everything ready. I got the flaps down as on final, and I came in. I had gone full pitch on the way around, coming in and down, getting towards the end of the runway. And just as I got there, I closed the throttle, touched on my left wheel, and as the tail came down, that was fine, it touched. Then the other one came down and grabbed. The left engine came off and tore away everything in front of me, broke the leg of the kid who was up for the ride.
Oh, jeez.
And I ended up in what was left of the airplane. My friend Ken Eastwood took my trip, who was, I can tell you about his language, he was lost with his Navigator. And that was very sad for me. So I wasn't blamed for the accident, of course, because he called me to try this, but there was no way it could have been saved because it grabbed.
Yeah,
instead, and he grabbed it, swung me around, and the engine came off, you know, and took away everything in front of me. It cut my shoe from here down to here to the soft part. So it didn't break the foot, but it was sprained
that
it
was pretty
badly.
Close.
And I went on ops the next night.
Wow.
I was in the hospital the night, but I went up the stairs on my heel, but I was limping for a while. But the poor kid with me, an air cadet, had a broken leg. So I was lucky to have had that kind of experience,
mm-hmm.
because it taught me how you have to be so careful with these airplanes.
Mm-hmm.
And when you turn to at the dispersal point, you don't lock one tire and rotate around it and pinch the tire. You leave it, keep the tire rolling as you come around. So I learned an awful lot from that.
So were your contemporaries, were they, when you first got on the Mosquito, was anyone really fearful of Mosquito, or is there a healthy amount of respect for the Mosquito, I'm guessing? Because it would seem like...
Oh, they had a very healthy respect for it. Well, Dr. Carr's son, David Carr, was a navigator who happened to go on Mosquitoes. His father took out my tonsils on our dining room table. So naturally, he and I were going to team up.
Yeah.
But, you know, I didn't drink a drop because, to begin with, I might lose my sense of, you know, awareness. I didn't smoke because I couldn't stand the stink. But on the drinking, I thought, so many guys go over there, they get half snapped, and they get shot down because maybe they weren't alert. So I thought, well, God, the first thing I'd happen to me, I'd get shot down, and if I happen to meet a girl and get married and there's a family on the way, what the hell happened to them then? I said, even worse, if we survived and I brought them home to Canada to my job as a delivery boy on a bike for $5 a week and made $4 board, that wouldn't go too well either. So I was as passionate as anybody, I avoided all that
contact. You just focused on what you're doing.
And I did meet a girl. Ken Eastwood introduced me to a very nice young lady, Jenny Jones. And he said, well, why aren't you writing? I said, well, you know, I can't take a chance on anything happening that would be a tragedy for her. So I'm doing what I did. So I went through the entire war without really ever knowing what being a man was in that sense of the word. But everybody, the first thing they did was to get out there and pick up a girl and smoke and drink and blah, 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 blah. But it kept me alert. And my navigator, of all things, got married just before he came overseas.
Oh, wow.
And I said, Paul, why would you do something? Oh, no, no, no. He had talked about his outer brother. But he was a marvelous navigator. So
let's talk about Paul for a second. So you met him while you were on the OTU.
I met Paul at the OTU. I was up, I had soloed, but I didn't have very many solo trips under my belt. He came down to the flight line and asked if he could go up for a ride. I said, well, you're certainly welcome to come along, but I've only got about 6 hours on this thing. I'm solo recently. He said, well, I don't care. So he got in. We flew, and he said, you know, we got down, he enjoyed it. We enjoyed the flying together, and but he is a smoker, but we didn't smoke. He didn't smoke in the airplane. But he talked about his outer brother, and that was kind of cute. And Tessie, his sister, wrote to me, and she was a good-looking girl, too. But anyway, there's no way I could get in any way attached. So I said, well, fine. I said, but okay. I want to have an understanding about something. If we get together, how would you like to win the Victoria Cross? He said, don't be stupid. I said, I agree with you. What I'll do then, and you agree to be with it, if I attack an airplane or a train, I will attack it once and give it my best shot. If I don't shoot him down like that, I'm not going back for a second bite. We both deserve to live. So that's fine by me. So we never went back. And I know guys specifically, one who shot down this twin engine airplane who was taking off. I can show his picture in the group. It was two Focke-Wulf 190s, which he shot. After takeoff, he came around, he saw another one.
He went back.
and he went back in. They shot him all to hell. Cocaine, his navigator, jumped out at about 300 feet and was killed, and he slammed in the head, and he was one of those cases that went for the big treatment of rebuilding his face and body. And but, you know, it isn't just superstition. You have to fly smart.
Yeah.
And you have to, it's, you're expected to do your job, but you do it as safely as they can because you want to keep doing your operations. We Canadians, we only had to do two tours. My British friends, they had no end. We had a squadron leader, Raybone, was on his first trip of his fifth tour.
Oof.
Who was lost going to Heligoland on a Mosquito.
Wow.
Fifth tour. And so I flew some pretty high class guys.
Okay, there was a lot of experience.
And I was 19. Mm-hmm. I was, at the time I was doing operations, I was 20. And I finished before I turned 21. And then I came back to Canada. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, off to China after that. Mm-hmm. But.
So where was Paul from?
Paul was from Montreal.
Montreal, was he? Yeah. Was he French Canadian or is he?
Yes, he was French Canadian. Okay. Paul Baudette, he talked about his other brother.
Yeah, yeah.
And Paul was a very good guy. He was quite a heavy smoker, but he did not fool around with the ladies. He was very true to his wife and
okay.
Yeah. He was very true to his wife, which was a help to me too, mm-hmm. because I wouldn't follow suit. And he went to the bar because he liked to have a drink and so forth. I went to the pool room and I learned to play three-ball billiards,
okay.
English billiards. And that was great. And I enjoyed the camaraderie of life in the mess. And to be of officer rank was great. Now, the other thing is, when we fly at night, operations or otherwise, after night flying, we would go to the sergeant's mess and they had a cauldron this big. Like a big pail like this with boiling water, they would drop an egg into it and then lift out this perfectly poached egg and put it on your plate on a piece of toast or something.
Mm.
That was the most delicious thing I have ever tasted in my whole life.
Really?
Oh, it was just awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And so...
that would be like after you got back from a mission or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And even if we were night flying, we'd go to the sergeant's mess, and that's where they would do this.
Mm.
But we had, the other thing is that the ladies in the MT section would drive us in these little 1500 weights back and forth with our gear to the airplane, which was right across the field. So we had lockers at the field on the near side where all the lockers were in the CO's office and the flight commander's offices. We had lockers where we kept our parachute and all that perfect paraphernalia. Down the road around the bend was where they had the station headquarters, where they'd have the other stuff, but and the briefings and so forth. But I made a point when I had finished my night flying test to leave everything right. The trims were set for takeoff. The switchers are all where they should be. And I knew where the gas was going to be selected, but mostly the trims were set. And everything like that at our fingertips, because we wore red goggles for an hour before we would come out to fly. And that meant that we could see in the dark.
So preserve your night vision.
Yes.
Okay.
So I had a night visual capacity of 22, which was rather high. But our peripheral vision is what we used when we were looking into the black.
Yep.
And I was able to see on the one night after attacking a JU-88 on approach and all the lights went out and I climbed up in the black. I saw a black form go by in the black. And I flew up past it and came around and got a chunk out of him. It was a Heinkel 111.
Wow.
And so we were able to use our peripheral vision. And we were able to, like if you're looking here, but it's here, you could read the, like a list of eight numbers, for giving a test. My navigator asked what they were, so I'd tell them what the numbers were. So we learned to use night vision as a tool, and our gun sight reticule was red.
Mm-hmm.
Our instruments were like flesh colored, but did not disturb your night vision. They didn't have the green phosphorus or luminous paint like a lot of airplanes do.
Mm-hmm.
Where it was sort of lit by UV, but visible, very visible, sharply visible, wonderful. And so we used to use that as a very great tool. And when you're in the black over England, is one thing. But in a black night over there is super black in the blackout. You get over enemy territory, it's very black. But in the blackest night, I could always see the difference between land and water.
Okay.
So that's what we did. We'd go in probably around 5,000 to 8,000 feet and change height and so forth. And I remember one time we were going to go to between Meppel and Zwolle. We went past Willemstad, and I said, okay, Paul, look back, and went to pull the stick back. There was a Junkers 88 in formation with me on my right, ready a few seconds later to go behind and blow my tail off like he did my CO.
Yeah.
Sticky Murphy. That's where he got it.
That's where he got it. Yeah.
But we had to keep saying, look back, Paul. But I did, that's the first, in over 1,100 mosquito hours, that's the first time that I went full throttle.
Oh, I bet.
The other time was in China when somebody plunked one down in an abandoned grass airfield with a stream going through the center, and I went down to retrieve it.
Yeah.
And the two engineers insisted on coming back with me. And I said, I may not get past that bloody fence down there. I said, we're still going back with you. So that time I went full throttle until it started to skid and then let it go. And 20 degrees of flap, and I just splashed, and we got through.